Architecture is the act of creating environments layered with memory. Memories of the place, memories of events, memories of nature, and memories of the architect. I think we can only move to create stuff that is part of our memory base, in the hope that we create environments where the end user can now make their own memories. Memories that in the future they will live in. And that, I think, for me is the hope for all the architecture and all the work that I do, is that this work become part of the memory base of people who come in contact with it. Having said that, the mere act of making buildings for me is not sufficient to be called architecture. It is necessary. That is to say that it is a necessary subset of architecture, but by itself, in and of itself, it is not architecture. And I really feel very strongly about this. I have come to this realization that really, that is the only way in which, at a very personal level, I can participate perpetually in the work that I create. Now, these environments can be both indoors, they can be outdoors, they can be permanent, they can be transient. The environment could be the environment of a painting. And if somehow it can be laced with my own memory and the memory of things, events, places from which that environment emerges, then I think it has the beginnings of architecture. And if it continues to transcend the boundaries of the medium, be it the act of building, be it the medium of construction, the medium of painting, the medium of photography, the medium of poetry. Eventually, if those memories can be transferred into the minds of the people who are responding to that piece of work or living in that piece of work, and as such, they have the opportunity to layer their own experiences onto this background noise, then I think that's architecture. The act of formalizing a structure, or the formal act of constructing geometries, pure explorations in the physical form, iterative design processes resulting in sometimes really beautiful objects, really beautiful things, that's not enough for me as an architect. I need much more. I need that those buildings are able to live with us, and we are able to live with and in those buildings, and in many cases around those buildings. Sometimes an object can be observed, but the way you observe it changes you, right? And also changes the way you interact with it. I think that is important. So it's very hard to sort of define finite boundaries of what architecture is and is not. But I think for me, the central theme is the theme of memory, is the theme of creating personal relationship through the medium of architecture, a relationship between the architect and the end users. It's understood that the medium of architecture is drawings, and the final output from an architecture office is a set of drawings. Therefrom, the construction industry takes over. So in principle, and I thought you asked me what Zaha meant that she's not responsible for. I mean, I think there is a sense that once those drawings are tight and they are fully coordinated and you hand them over to a project management consultancy firm or to a contractor or to a construction manager, whoever you hire, then it becomes a responsibility of the construction industry to actually execute that building. Albeit architects are called for design supervision to make sure that the intent of the drawings is carried through, but in principle, we are no more master masons in the sense that we don't go and build the buildings. I think people are people. Now, I can say this because a lot of our work is single family homes, so the scale is much more intimate. Projects are much smaller. They range from 3,000 square feet to 30,000 square feet on an average. Occasional school or occasional resort, you know, where it's 4 lakh square feet or something, that's a whole other ball game. But by and large, in my practice, The real operative range is 3,000 to 30,000 square feet. Now, at any given time when my staff or I visit the site, and we visit quite often, we have the opportunity to interact with individual craftspersons. I mean, we have an opportunity to walk up a scaffold and see what the rough carpenter is doing. If we recognize them first and foremost as human beings and are inherently interested in their life, then we can strike up a conversation. And I think once that conversation becomes a little deeper, in the sense that there is a personal inquiry, oh, where are you from, what do you do, and it's out of real curiosity, it's not some game that we are playing with them, but it is a real interest in who these human beings are, because very often the construction staff is not local to the place where we build. So they're coming from Bengal, from Bihar, some from Karnataka. So there are all sorts of people from different walks of life. Many of them skilled craftspersons, but many of them are people who have no other job. So they may be trained as educators, but they're doing rough carpentry simply to earn a living. Now that's an interesting story. So if we can develop, and I really, really, really strongly believe this, that if we can develop a personal relationship with these people, and in that, within the umbrella of that relationship, discuss the importance of the work that they are doing towards the end result of our architecture, we've struck a chord. And I think that the dynamics and the mood of that relationship shows up in the final building. Just like when your grandmother makes food for you, it always tastes special. I mean, it is special because she has kind of taken care while making it, and she has pleasant thoughts, and there is an intention to feed you, her grandson. So there is a degree of love sort of sprinkled into the mix. And I think that's also true of architecture. I think that's true of all art. I mean, if art is not an act of love, then I really just don't know what art really is. I mean, that's really important. So, coming back to your question, I think it is not necessary. And it is true that it's very hard. And it is also true that within the common perception of the profession of architecture as it stands today, these are two completely different industries, but there are bridges that can be built. And I think, at least at certain scales of operation, especially the single family or schools where individuals are in intimate relationship with the building, that is important in gardens, in landscape. I think it is crucial that the landscape architect have a relationship with the gardener, with the horticulturist, because these are living things we are talking about. You cannot ignore it. That anyways is my point. To respond to the individual right of freedom, of free will, of free expression, that is to be ethical. So although architecture may not always be social, in the sense that it may not always be doing stuff for the society at large, it absolutely needs to be always ethical. And I think the first step towards ethics is authenticity. If I am not authentic, I think it would be very hard for me to be ethical. Like everything else, it's not just enough to be authentic to be ethical. There are a lot of other things that are layered upon the canvas of authenticity that make us ethical. But I think first and foremost, architecture needs to be ethical. It needs to be ethical at very mundane levels. Levels such as accessibility. I mean, the building that we make needs to be accessible for everybody. Two profound levels, in the sense that the building's internal emotional chiaroscuro needs to be accessible to the end users. I mean, if we make a building that is only accessible to people who are well-educated, that's not equal opportunity. I think one of the responsibilities that I assume as an architect is to make buildings that are complex yet accessible emotionally, metaphysically, artistically, and finally physically. I don't think any one thing or any one person or any one idea or any one profession can save anything, let alone the world. But I definitely think that every profession, every individual, every idea can and should do something about it. And that, I think, is definitely possible. It could be something completely ridiculous like taking bucket baths instead of shower baths. That's a behavior pattern. So what I'm trying to say is that a behavior pattern can create a brief, and we can ask our architects to be judicious about material use, right? And we can start looking at net carbon footprint. And if we look at that, again, sincerely, then of course we do something about the environment. But to say that can architecture alone make a difference, I think that's too much to ask for. And that's too much to ask off of anyone or anything or any profession. But each of us has a role to play, and we have to play it. I mean, that's as simple as that. A big part of being conscious of our environment, being conscious of our future, the future of our planet, is being conscious of our own ways. I mean, it's a personal journey. I mean, I love to sleep in an air-conditioned room. And for me, a big part of my personal journey is to limit the use of air conditioning, right, to absolutely the bare minimum in a year. And eventually my goal is to train my body to just not require air conditioning. It's just a small example. Which means that my architecture has to produce rooms that are cool even in the heat of summer. So yes, of course there is environmental stewardship. It's not just the building. So for example, many years ago, I was designing the American Embassy School in New Delhi and the middle school. And one of the things that the school did was that in order to reduce the carbon footprint, they said no non-vegetarian meals on campus, fully vegetarian meals. So there are things like that. So, you know, it's not just the building that becomes green. I think it is who inhabit it, how we live in it, how we behave in the building. And yes, in that sense, the building allows us to behave a certain way. So if the building is perpetually hot, I mean, you're going to need air conditioning because you're just not going to be comfortable in it. But if we are able to make a building that is comfortable to begin with, obviously the use of air conditioning goes down because its need sort of starts to fall apart. And so yes, I think architecture can contribute to saving or extending the life, at least as we know it, of our planet. The only thing that I say to myself with respect to everything that I do is, Chaitanya, be authentic. Be authentic to yourself. Be authentic to your experience. Be authentic to the roots you come from. And I think that's the advice I will give young architects. If you are authentic, that authenticity will be recognizable. Being authentic is not just Santa Monica catchphrase. I mean, I think being authentic also embodies the fact that we are nourished from our roots, in the sense that the soil in which our seed is planted informs every leaf that grows on the tree of who we become. I mean, there is a continuity, a continuum between how we sleep, who we date, what food we like, what music we listen to, the houses we build, the friends we make, and eventually the clients who come to us. I think it is less important to keep reinventing ourselves, but rather the focus should be on evolving. And I think evolution is always undertaken within a climate. As the climate changes, we need to evolve to adapt to that climate. I think semantically, I'm more comfortable with the word evolution than the word reinvention, because in the word reinvention, there is the sense that one may have to, not always necessarily, but one may have to completely disconnect from our past and then completely reinvent yourself, you know. So you lose your connection to your history. That doesn't sit happily with me. I think we are our history. I mean, an individual is his or her history. A building is his or her history. And I mean, not history in the kind of historic sense of the word, but history in sort of the trajectory of events that lead up to who we are now, what we do now, what we think is good, bad, what gives us pleasure, what makes us sad now. I think it's all a culmination and a mix up of our histories. So I think the only thing I will say to young architects is work hard to be authentic. And I say work hard because it requires work. It requires to check every choice that we make, because very often our family, our friends, families we don't choose, friends very often are kids who live in our society or kids who we go to school with. So in a sense, we don't choose them. Classmates, again, we don't really choose them. Right? So all these groups of people, and I'm convinced that they all have an ulterior motive, push and pull us to do things that they believe is convenient for the dynamic of that relationship. And somewhere in that, we tend to lose our authenticity. Now, those experiences do become part of our memory base and eventually inform who we become. But I think that those things are the climate within which we can adapt and evolve without losing sense of who we are authentically. So looking at a magazine and building the way the magazine gives currency to a typology of building in the contemporary sense of the word, I'm not a big fan of that. This is not to say that somebody cannot do that. I feel it is important to be who we are, be authentic. People will recognize it. People will come to us for our belief systems. At the end of the day, we are like magicians, you know. We take rubble and cement and all these random things, color, and put together and create some space in which our clients live. They have their happy moments. They have their quarrels. They experience sadness. You know, they have their first child. It's beautiful. I mean, we are magicians. I mean, and for us to be magicians, I think it is important for us to be authentic. Functionality and architecture needs the plural. I think architecture has functions, right? And one function, one of the functions of architecture is the function of feeling. The function of emotion, the function of being able to allow the end user to explore their own memories, create new memory, to live a life in and around a building. So I think it is important that we understand this to be also a function of architecture. Where I'm going with this is that a kitchen where you can just cook is not enough for it to become architecture. But if you make a kitchen in which you cannot cook, that also is a disservice to the project of making a kitchen. I mean, ironically, this question never comes to me because I believe that a kitchen, you should be able to cook in. If you make an instrument, you should be able to play music on that instrument. But just because you can play music on an instrument doesn't make you a musician, doesn't make you an artist. It could make you a musician, but not really an artist, because to be an artist, you have to bear your soul through the medium for everyone to see and for everyone to take part in, participate in. That I think is also true of architecture. You cannot compromise function, the kind of the classical function of architecture, but then there are also all these other para functions without which all you will remain with is a building, a built form. And I don't think it will be elevated to the status of architecture. For architecture to be built, you need a client to want to have faith in you and then want to spend a lot of money and time and effort to allow us to build what we want to build. Whereas a musician can take up the music instrument, play the form, and that's it. A painter can paint and walk away. So the expense incurred to really make architecture is incommensurate with the expense required to indulge in many of the other arts, right? So, of course, the client is important. Now, the client is important because the client, one, needs to have faith in us, implicit faith in us, that we will do what is right for them. We also need to be honest and sincere and be committed to the cause that we are going to do what is fair and what is just with respect to our client. I mean, we have to be rigorous so that we don't waste our client's time and money. And more than time and money, we don't waste the client's opportunity, which he's sharing with us to participate in a big event of their life. I mean, when someone builds a house or when a client builds a school, that's an event. I mean, this is a big event for a big part of their private time that they have with themselves. That's all that they're thinking of. We need to be responsible towards that. Our job is to understand from the client exactly what they want, then use our experience, use our study and our ability to translate our memories, our client's memories, the memories of the site, the memories of the society into something tangible, something contemporary, something, by contemporary I mean in the present moment, something now that can become the base from which the client or the end users can form new memories, new stories. I think we are the background for the stories of people's lives, and I think that's very, very important for us to understand that. We can only mold the client's aspirations to the extent that we are comfortable doing and to the extent that has a direct relationship to who we are, to where we come from, to what our experience base is, what our taste is, you know. Eventually, a building designed by me or by another architect or by a famous architect will always, without question, bear their mark if they have been authentic. And actually bear their mark even if they have not been authentic. I mean, that is an inescapable reality of the project of architecture. We will always bear our mark on it. So yes, it's a combination of both. Tom Main was my thesis instructor at grad school. He was fantastic for many reasons. I mean, one of the reasons why he was fantastic was because he burned with a passion for architecture and everything architectural. I mean, he loved this profession. He loved this profession, and that is infectious, you know. In his mind, there was no ambiguity that this is the profession. I mean, he got up every morning, came to school, went to work, saw a client, did whatever he did so that he could do architecture better. It's sort of very similar to what happens with the gopis in Vrindavan, many of whom are married but still in love with Sri Krishna. So they get up, do all the chores of daily life, prepare food for their husbands, pack tiffins for their children, do the churning of yogurt, do everything so that in their day, they get at least 5 minutes to think of the real object of their affection, Sri Krishna. I mean, that was Tom Main. I mean, he constantly came down to architecture. That was the first thing that left an impression on my mind. Second thing was that he was authentic. I mean, this guy really was not bullshitting. He was authentic about where he came from. He was authentic about his experiences. There was an authenticity about the time in which he was educated and the time frame in which his work came to fruition. He was completely authentic. I mean, if he didn't know something, he didn't know something. What he would do is he would go and find out what that something is. But there was no second-hand information. It was first-hand information. And I think that is extremely important for all of us to keep in mind, because it's very easy to spread and use secondhand information, but it is really not authentic. As an educator, what was very important that he dedicated a serious amount of time towards his students. There were other instructors at school at that time who would never show up. We, on the other hand, had him constantly. Mm-hmm. He would take us to site regularly. We would have lunches and dinners where we would discuss architecture. We would visit his home, we would visit his office constantly. To the extent that you could actually wonder, did he really have a personal life? But what is important is that there is no kind of distinction between his personal life and his professional life and his life as a teacher. They are all one. They are seamlessly woven together. You know, it's a meshwork. And I think that is beautiful. That is a lesson which was very similar, which is very similar to the Guru Shishya Parampara, or the system in which at least I was taught music, and which is how Indian education system used to be. Unfortunately, there are very few places in India where education is taken up thus. But these were, I think, really important things I took away from Thom, and I am eternally grateful to him for that. I think there is an ambiguity that is born out of ignorance, not knowing, you know, just walking into a situation and then kind of fumbling your way through the situation. That produces an ambiguity which I think is clumsy when you look at it, right? Then there is another ambiguity which comes from sincere rigor. You know, someone has done the due diligence, and then there are still some things that you just cannot know at the present moment in time. So when we build architecture, or when we come up with an idea, or when we come up with a speculation that we want to test through our design process or build into a building, by nature it's going to be ambiguous, because you cannot at any given point in time really know everything about anything. You can know something about most things, but it is almost impossible to know everything about anything. I mean, it's like this uncertainty principle. You know, I mean, you can either know the velocity or the position of an electron. You cannot simultaneously know both. And that's beautiful. I mean, that ambiguity is beautiful. And architecture as a project cannot escape from it. Why do people take to porn? There is an extreme psychosis, or there is an addiction to porn, which is an addiction like everything else, compulsive behavior. But then most people take to porn as a way of experiencing themselves without the pressure of satisfying someone else, without taking the risk of emotionally harming someone else, and so on and so forth. And I think architecture is not that to shelter. Because shelter is shelter. It has a very specific requirement that it needs to shelter an organism or a group of people or human beings from the elements. It needs to provide a place for community to live, or for a family to live out their lives. But architecture is much more. Architecture deals with the emotional and intellectual needs of human beings. It's not just about satisfying the physical needs, right? So, in fact, quite the contrary. I would say that mere shelter making is porn when you compare it with the act of love making, which to me is architecture. Architecture is much, much more than just making a building. It really is where the entire faculty of human experience comes to bear on every single micro-minutia event. Even sitting on a WC to take your morning dump can be an experience, you know? That's architecture's job. So no, architecture is not porn at all.